Bolinda presents this unabridged recording of On the Road with Kids, written by John Ahern and read by Michael Veitch. Travel is at its most rewarding when it ceases to be about realising a destination and becomes indistinguishable from living your life. Paul Theroux. There is nothing like returning to a place that remains unchanged to find the ways in which you yourself have changed. Nelson Mandela. Chapter 1. Living Between the Lines. I've always liked plane travel at night. It's as if I'm in a dark, peaceful bubble being soothed by the gentle throb of the engine and the repetitive hum of the air conditioning. No one can bother me. Except for tonight. Tonight I had the seat from hell. I was on the aisle in the centre row of four. A small, noisy girl was next to me, then her mother, then a smaller, louder boy. The children were bouncing on the chairs and over the harried woman, flicking lights on and off, wailing, and slapping over juice cups as though they were bowling pins. The mother had clearly lost control. Every now and then the little girl froze and gave me a demonic stare. I burrowed deeper into my blanket, hoping to be too inanimate to be of interest. Closing my eyes, I wished myself back to my high-flying corporate days when I sometimes flew business class. Flat beds, fine wines, no plastic forks, movies of choice, and best of all, no kids. As though telepathic, an air hostess soon glided down the aisle, winked conspiratorially and offered me a row of three empty seats away from the adjoining circus. I hesitated for an appropriate second, then launched across the aisle as though shot from an ejector seat. When my wife, Mandy, distracted by another of our kids' drink spills, finally noticed my absence, she looked at me as though I had just taken the last chopper out of a hot zone. Mandy and I took turns in the three-seat row during the flight, allowing me space to think about what lay ahead. There were a lot of unknowns to consider. I may have been strapped in by the seatbelts, but couldn't restrain my thoughts from running off in anticipation. They all focused on the seven-berth motorhome waiting for us in the Netherlands. Months earlier, we'd zapped off €14,000 to buy it over the internet. I was slightly concerned we'd been sucked into an internet scam, but the image of this wonderful craft had been seared into my mind for months, even dreamt about for years, and had recently transformed into a magical starship that promised to provide our travelling family with nirvana for the next year. Consequently, 2 days later, on a grey Tuesday morning in August, on the way to view this new motorhome, I was so excited I was quivering more than a wet puppy in a cold wind. The dream was about to come true. Donna, an eccentric Dutch-American who bought and sold used motorhomes for a living, chatted away about her cats while weaving her little red Fiat from lane to lane down the motorway out of Utrecht. As her car could only carry one passenger, Mandy and the kids had remained back at the hotel, mainly because I had begged and pleaded with Mandy to be the first to drive the machine. Donna soon pulled off the highway, and the car bounced down a narrow dirt path, stopping behind a dilapidated old farmhouse and windmill. "It's here, John," she pointed to the windmill. It seemed a very strange place for a professional operation to store motorhomes. Donna jumped out of her car and wrenched back the windmill's big timber doors in a surprising show of strength. "Look, look at it," she cried. I peered beyond the doors and felt an instant gush of relief. Inside the shed were rows of renovated, gleaming antique cars. Donna obviously had a passion for autos and was just the right person, I thought, to have cared for our new home during the past few months since we'd bought it. I squinted further into the dark recesses of the shed, eager for the first view of the motorhome, as though on a blind date. Donna flicked a switch, the lights blinked, and a dark shape slowly came into focus. I gaped in silence, frozen to the ground. This first sight of our new motorhome was supposed to be a moment of exultation, of trumpets blaring hallelujah, declaring a life-reclaiming event was about to begin. Instead, I stared in complete and utter devastation. In the rear corner of the shed sat a big white box with faded red racing stripes down the side. The engine hood was open, with cables attached to various parts as though it were on life support. The thing was covered in a thick film of dust. It sat there discarded, disowned and decrepit, in teasing contrast to the sparkling antiques surrounding it. "It had some problems getting it started," Donna said. "Uh-huh," was my reply. Mandy and I had gambled everything for this shit heap. We had no jobs, no income, and had just torn a hole in our savings. Our car was sold, the house rented, probably to the Manson family. All our beloved possessions were in a storage shed gathering cobwebs. We were about to launch into a world without TV, internet, telephones, friends, family, toys, or schooling for the kids. We had an old laptop with some children's DVDs, one small backpack of clothes each, and no idea where we were going or for how long. And I was about to sleep, eat, pee, and shower together with my wife and our two kids for a year in this rolling box smaller than our bedroom. I stared long and hard at the motorhome, wondering again how I'd got here. It all began on Christmas Day the year before. My brother-in-law Terry and I had been playing a swashbuckling game of table tennis, progressively hitting the balls harder as we smashed our way around. Two male egos in our own gladiatorial ping-pong arena. With 2 points to win, I launched across the table wildly. Swinging the bat in a long arc, pain ripped into my back as though a sniper had shot me with a hot bullet. In noiseless slow motion, I landed on the ground. For long seconds, I lay there staring at the sky, waiting, blinking. "Get up, you wimp!" came the call from across the net. I moved and cried out in pain. I immediately thought I'd burst a disc, but I was wrong. I had burst two discs, the lower two. This was the first in a series of shock strikes that would create the revolutionary period I would later refer to as when my back went snap and my career went poof. I was mostly bedridden for the next 2 weeks, sucking on Valium pills like they were sugar-coated lollies. The drugs worked on my back but could not dull my whirring brain. I insisted on working, literally flat out, making calls to the office from my bed and whacking away on the laptop day and night. I was on the executive team for a global public listed company and had been negotiating to buy another company in India for the past year. It had become my own personal mission that I lived and breathed. Unfortunately, my kids didn't understand the gravity of the situation. They kept surging into my bedroom, curious and entertained by the sight of their dad, horizontal and at home, during the day. My 4-year-old daughter Jamie, as usual, led the charge one sunny morning, her blonde hair falling down over her blue eyes and freckles. She stood, smiling in her giraffe pyjamas with a hopeful glint in her eye, the spokesperson for every plot she and her 2-year-old brother Callum hatched. He was smaller, with his grandmother's olive skin and a mop of brown hair, and stood loyally next to her in red Spider-Man pyjamas waiting for my attention. They reminded me of C-3PO and R2-D2, the taller, chatty one always blaming the littler one who couldn't speak properly for anything that went wrong. "Do you want to play dolly with us?" "Please," Jamie pleaded, handing me her unattractive doll. I held Scary Dolly, as she was affectionately known, up in front of my laptop. "Ah, I can't, kiddies, I have to work." Scary Dolly and her two pyjama-clad sidekicks would have to wait. "Aw, can you sing Barbie Girl with us?" That was one of my specialities. "Nope, sorry, later." The faces dropped, and soon they scurried off, but my eyes followed them, a little thought drifting like a ghost behind them. I started replaying the past few days and nights. I'd watch Mandy pick the kids up and put them to bed while I stood by like a broken appendage. When would I be able to hold them? And how could I keep a job if I couldn't sit upright? My work? Shit, my work. What was I doing? I had no time for these distractions. I turned back to my computer, but soon floated further off into weird thought bubbles of acute clarity, losing hours staring at the ceiling, thinking. Pop. My work sucked. Well, more so the people, not the actual work. I had buried this knowledge for some time, but the unusual cocktail of excessive spare time, a comfy big bed and Valium pills, had burst the thought wide open. An influx of new people had created a pervading me culture at work. Trust and loyalty were eroding. Redundancies were happening for the first time. I had revelled in the company for over a decade, and I wasn't averse to change, but not like this. Weeks later, I popped painkillers to attend an important board meeting to summarise the Indian deal. After so much isolated time in bed, my brain was whirring with conflicting thoughts, and I entered the boardroom in a rather skittish frame of mind. The chairman was a legend of the corporate scene who delivered questions rapid-fire and expected precise answers. I was soon given the floor, but was immediately cut off by one of my team members who took over the presentation. I was gobsmacked, but decided a confrontation in front of the board would not be good. Instead, I eased back into my chair and tried to look unflustered. The presentation started with, "As John was not available," confirming the me games I had avoided so well were now upon me. I don't know if it was the Valium or my sudden wish to be transported from the situation, but my mind drifted off to memories of a fellow I'd contracted to paint my house years earlier. I remembered he was always up on the roof, which was odd given I wasn't getting the roof painted. "Hey, Jono," he screamed one afternoon. "Can't you see it, man?"
"See what?"
I jumped, looking around for a snake.
"The lines," the mad painter yelled. "You're living between the lines, man."
Standing in my shiny polyester grey suit, the 25-year-old me yelled upwards,
"What are you talking about, man?"
This was back when it was cool to call everyone man.
"The fucking lines, man. They're trying to box us in. Everywhere you go, there are lines. This block of land,"
he waved his paintbrush,
"fences, driving down the road, fucking lanes, queuing at the bank, swim between the flags. They're trying to cage us in, man."
I laughed.
"Don't worry, man, it won't happen to me." "Ha! You're already trapped, you poor bastard," he screeched. "You know it. Hopping to the beat, playing the games. Get out, escape, while you can."
Was that even possible? It occurred to me that this boardroom world had played a large part in snuffing out the adventure in my existence. Riding on the rooftops of buses in Africa or stowing away on a Colombian cargo plane over the Amazon felt like dreams rather than memories. I heard my name and snapped back to attention, then realised it was only being used in the context of me not being available the last few weeks. I chuckled, but it wasn't a happy chuckle. What folly, I thought. Here I was, barely able to sit up, and playing around me was a game of ego. My biggest worry over the past month had not been that I couldn't carry my kids to bed, but rather that some business in India might not get purchased. There was something awfully wrong with my priorities, and right then, the stranger I'd become finally struck me. I was dragging myself to meetings at the expense of my health and ignoring my family at the same time. My career had become a defining priority. My social life was my work life. Adventure was a bygone concept. The mad painter was right. I had to escape.
"Anything else to add, John, from your perspective?"
The pointed question jolted me out of my delirious state. All the important faces wheeled around at me like gun turrets. I stared back down their barrels, taking in each one of them. I saw mentors, good guys and sociopaths. The seconds ticked away as they waited for my reply. My statement needed to be witty, detailed, professional and balanced. I had to brilliantly retake control. But I no longer wanted to play. Suddenly all seemed so silly. My leg was jiggling under the table. It was a moment of discovery that I will never forget. It was the moment for my working world that I no longer gave a fuck. I didn't even get up. I just took a deep breath, hoisted the white flag and said, "Nope." In the taxi home, I became marginally psychotic, slapping myself on the forehead for my stupidity. Then I laughed, crazy like a demon. Then reality knocked again. I may have wanted to stick my middle finger in the air towards the working world, but I didn't have that luxury. I was a husband and a father of two. I was the current breadwinner. We had a mortgage and responsibilities. My nope was a blip. It had to be. With the acceptance that career and parenthood had captured my life, I trudged back into my house and slumped down on the couch, feeling like I may as well have sawn off my own testes and hung them in the company trophy cabinet. The house was in darkness. The kids were in bed. It was a familiar scene. Me arriving home late, Emile sitting on the kitchen bench with plastic covering it, waiting to be reheated. Mandy bounced down the stairs, keen to talk to someone over the age of 4. I filled her in on my mad moment of surrender and started discussing my unavoidable fight back before being interrupted by the kids' yells about a spider in their room. Mandy went to investigate, leaving me on the couch, thinking. It was becoming a dangerous pastime, this thinking. I knew that something had broken in me that day, and I knew I should be the one smashing that huntsman. Spider killing was one of my key roles in the family, and yet my back meant I couldn't even do that. What was left?
Mandy returned. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.